در حالی که امروز روز جهانی زن است، زنان افغان تحت چه شرایط زندگی می کنند؟ چقدر توجه و رسیدگی به زنان افغان تا اینجای کار صورت گرفته است؟ شرایط زندگی زنان در افغانستان تحت حاکمیت امارات اسلامی چگونه است؟ و جامعه جهانی که همواره خود را مدافع حقوق بشری می داند، چقدر به نیازمندی های زنان افغان رسیدگی کرده است؟ سلام، وقتتان بخیر. آقای مارکوس پوتسل، معاون فرستاده ویژه سازمان ملل متحد و همچنان خانم الیسون دویدین، فرستاده این سازمان در بخش زنان، مهمانان این گفتگوی ویژه ما هستند. من حامد بهرام میزبان شما آقای پوتسل و خانم الیسون هستم. Mr. Marcus Putzel, Deputy Special Representative of the United Nations Secretary General, and Ms. Alison Davidian, UN Woman Representative in Afghanistan. Welcome and thank you for coming here. آقای پوتسل، در حالی که امروز روز جهانی زن هست، پیام سازمان ملل متحد به افغانستان و ویژه به زنان افغان چیست؟
روز جهانی زن یک روز همبستگی است و در این حال هم درخواست اقدامات بیشتر برای برابری جنسیتی است. ما می‌بینیم که وضعیت زنان در افغانستان شاید بدترین وضعیت تمام جهان باشد. ما می‌بینیم که اقدامات بیشتر لازم هستند برای بهتر شدن شرایط زنان. افغانستان تنها کشور است در سطح جهانی که زنها از حقوق کار، حقوق تحصیل منع شدند. هم هیچ کشور اسلامی دیگر چنین قوانین را ندارد و پیام ما به مقامات حاکم روشن است. از این ممنونیت ها به خاطر تمام مردم افغانی، به خاطر آینده افغانستان برداشته شده باشند.
بله.
و ما پیام همبستگی را می‌فرستیم نه فقط به زنها و دختران، هم برای مردان افغانستان. و از مردان افغانستان هم درخواست می‌کنم که از زنان، دختران، مادران، خواهران پشتیبانی می‌کنند.
بله. آقای پوتسل، در حالی که مسائل بیشتر یا بحران‌های بیشتر دامنگیر افغانستان هست، چرا سازمان ملل بیشتر تمرکز بر مسائل حقوق بشری به ویژه مسائل حقوق زنان در افغانستان داره؟
خوب، درست است که بحران عمیق اقتصادی و انسانی وجود دارد در افغانستان، اما فکر می‌کنیم که افغانستان، ما افغانستان را می‌بینیم که جای شایسته‌اش را خود را به دست آورد در میان کشورهای جهان. و ما افغانستان را می‌بینیم یک کشور در سال و با آینده روشن برای تمام افغان‌ها این می‌بینیم. اما این ما هم مقامات حاکم ما می‌گویند که همین آرزو دارند، اما ما فکر می‌کنیم که ممکن نیست که نصف نفوس افغانستان چیز از بین برده می‌شود، یعنی از حق خود به کار، به تحصیل ممنوع شوند. به این علت فکر میکنیم که این ممنوعیت ها، این تصمیم ها که گرفته شده است تاثیر منفی دارد به تمام نفوس افغانستان، نه تنها خانم ها. و این تصمیم ها هم تمام کشور را عقب میکشنند، این کشور را به فقر، انزوا روبرو میکنند و این افغانستان را به یک افغانستان زیبا با مردم شجاع و سرافراز به کشور تبدیل میکنند.
بله.
که شهروندانش فقط میتوانند چیز فرار کنند.
بسیار تشکر برمیدم به شما و مسلما پرسش های دیگری هم در رابطه با حقوق زن در افغانستان دارم. مسلیسون، it's good to have you. As today is the International Women's Day, what sort of picture do you have of the Afghan woman?
Over the past year and a half, we have seen that there have been ongoing restrictions on women and girls' ability to access education, to access work, and to be able to access public life. But even in the face of all of these challenges, Afghan women are continuing to resist and continuing to fight for their right to have free and equal lives. And as UN Women, we will continue to advocate with the Taliban authorities for their right to contribute to Afghanistan's peace and development.
And as a UN woman representative in Afghanistan, how much effective were you in your mission here in Afghanistan and trying to force the authorities here to reconsider their decisions, as you just pointed out, regarding schools, restrictions, and all those limitations?
So as UN Women, we engage with the Taliban jointly with UNAMA and also with our humanitarian partners. And we also engage with the Taliban at provincial level to facilitate opening up of spaces for our partners, women civil society organizations, to deliver life-saving services for women. Now, with the recent ban on women working in NGOs, many of these spaces have had to close down. But we will continue to advocate and to engage with the Taliban authorities for women to be able to work, for services to be able to be delivered, for women to be able to access education, girls able to access education, and to be able to access public life. It's for women and girls, but it's also for Afghanistan and its future. It's critical for women and girls to be able to contribute to Afghanistan's peace and development, for Afghanistan to be able to chart a way through crisis, and also to be able to reach its full potential.
And you have been trying and engaging with the de facto authorities from the past 18 months. Do you see any progress, and are you hopeful that there might be any changes and the removal of these sanctions and restrictions?
So over the last 18 months, we have not seen progress in terms of girls going to school, women being able to go to university, women being able to access work. This month, March, will be almost a year and a half since girls have not been able to go to high school, the fourth month since women have not been able to go to university, also the fourth month since women have not been able to work in NGOs. So it has been, it's very concerning. But we do know that from the international community to even community leaders in Afghanistan, there's unity in believing that women and girls should be able to have a place in educational institutions and also for women to be able to go to work. And so we'll continue to engage with the Taliban to really advocate for women and girls to be able to reach their full potential through school, through work, but also for Afghanistan to be able to reach its full potential as well.
Thank you. Mr. Puzza, do you think secondary schools will be reopened at the start of the new academic year? Are you hopeful?
I know this point, I'm not very optimistic, but it's a must, and women, girls have to have the right to go to school and to universities. And if one day secondary schools, universities will be reopened, then not because the international community asked for it, but it's the wish of the Afghan people.
And you have been engaging with the DFA, de facto authorities as well. What's their viewpoint right now on human rights, and especially on reopening schools, universities, and to get the women back to the workforce?
I mean, we do both. We engage with the de facto authorities. At the same time, we criticize them for these measures. And when we engage them at highest level here in Kabul, then we ask for reopening of girls' schools, we ask for reopening of universities for women, but we also ask for female NGO workers to resume their work, to be able to work. And we ask that women overall in Afghanistan can enjoy their rights. And Afghanistan has subscribed to many conventions granting human rights, especially for women and girls, and they should stick and abide by these rules and regulations they have subscribed to.
And if schools and universities remain shut and only the statements exchanges between two sides, international community and the de facto authorities, what effect it will have on a generation in Afghanistan?
I mean, the UN as a whole, INAMA, and also the funds, programs, and agencies are here to help the Afghan people. Mm-hmm. We're also here to monitor, to observe the latest developments, and we are here to interact and engage with the de facto authorities. We think that it would not be good for Afghanistan, for the people of Afghanistan, if Afghanistan was an isolated country. So we try to engage. We also try to be a bridge builder between the people of Afghanistan and the international community.
Right. Mr. Lyson, how much is the international community committed to uphold the human rights in Afghanistan, and particularly women rights?
The international community is committed to...
And the United Nations as well.
And the United Nations, yes. Absolutely is committed to upholding mm-hmm. the rights of women and girls. And supporting Afghan women to be able to fight for their right to live free and equal lives. So that is unchanged. That
we have been witnessing many and numerous sessions and meetings mm-hmm. on human rights, especially on women's rights in Afghanistan, but none had effects or could change the Afghan women's situation. What was the reason why they weren't effective in changing the situation in Afghanistan?
Well, it continues to be a process, and it continues mm-hmm. to be a long struggle. No country in the world has achieved gender equality, and it's a struggle for every country in the world. What we would say, though, is that we know that report after report testify to the same principle, that vibrant economies, that sustainable peace, that economic development is all linked to having equality between men and women, and that Afghan women need to be part of public life and political life for Afghanistan in order to realize peace and development. And so this is not just about Afghan women and girls and their rights, this is about the future of Afghanistan and its ability to chart a way through crisis and into peace and development.
And one of the questions I was given from the woman, it was I was told to raise it from NTU. Like majority of the Afghans, they criticize the international community, the United Nations as well, saying that they are fighting here in Afghanistan, advocating for their rights in a very difficult juncture. But there are women outside of the country entitled champions. They receive trophies and all of sort of other achievements. Like, is there a double standard towards the Afghan women who are here inside Afghanistan and those who are outside?
So as UN Women, we see our role as really elevating the voices and the priorities of mm-hmm. Afghan women inside the country, as well as creating spaces where they're able to share their priorities and their demands with the international community. So our focus has always been on supporting Afghan women inside the country. Of course, we know that there are many Afghan women who are in exile mm-hmm. And who also have their priorities and their demands of what happens and what needs to happen going forward for Afghanistan. It's not about only having one voice. There are many Afghan women with many different viewpoints and priorities. And what is key right now as an international community is that we create spaces for all those views and priorities to be heard, not to shut anything down.
Right. Mr. Putza, it's believed that whenever you're talking about the human rights in Afghanistan, especially women's rights, it is like you're trying to impose, the entire team, the United Nations, trying to impose Western style of the human rights in Afghanistan. These are the comments that we have. What comments do you have on these allegations? And are you really trying to impose the Western sort of style of human rights in Afghanistan or no?
I've heard these allegations as well. Mm-hmm. We as the UN represent the values of the member states of the United Nations. Mm-hmm. And there are conventions and documents. There's the Human Rights, Universal Declaration of Human Rights. There's the UN Charter. By the way, Afghanistan was one of the first countries who subscribed to both the UN Charter and the Declaration of Human Rights, and they are applicable for all members of the international community and for all members of the United Nations. So I do not agree with the notion that these values are being imposed of Afghanistan on Afghanistan by Western countries, because look at the Security Council, for instance. There are also countries like Russia and China who are also behind these values.
And if you're not trying to impose those Western sort of style or human rights in Afghanistan, but it's believed that human rights are observed based on Sharia law, then it seems there is a conflict of ideas in between. How can you overcome that?
If you look around at the international community, it doesn't have to be a conflict. There are Islamic countries which are also applying Sharia law. And women can go to school, can work and have their rights. So it needn't be a contradiction.
And do you see there is a commonality in defining human rights in general, so that both sides, two sides, could reach an agreement with that?
As I said, you know, other countries, I mean, the authorities, de facto authorities here in Afghanistan, always claim we are unique, we are not taking any other Islamic country as an example. But I mean, Afghanistan is not an isolated country in this world. I mean, you don't live alone on your own. And if you look around, there are many countries in the world, Islamic countries including, who apply Sharia law and human rights at the same time. So it's not, it doesn't exclude each other.
Ms. Allison, what is the political participation of women? That it's always emphasized by the international community. United Nations as well in their meeting emphasized on that. So while the de facto authorities here claim that women can work, or they're already a part of police, some private sectors and other sectors which is needed, then what sort of political participation does the United Nations mean?
So when we talk about women's political participation, we're talking about the ability for women to engage in political life. It can be in a whole range of different areas and forms. And we know that when women do engage in political life, it actually gives more credibility to the government and the governing structure. It also allows for the government to be able to address more diverse populations. Actually, we also see that there are higher standards of living when women are also engaged in political life. So we've seen positive developments in terms of health, education, infrastructure, ending violence against women. So when women are able to engage politically in different forms, then really the whole country benefits.
And do you see that if you're witness the return of women in politics, or they participate in political structure or sort of a thing, will it lead to normalization of relationship between the government here and with the United Nations and in general the international community as well?
It's one factor, I think, among many. I mean, we're also looking at, as we know, girls being able to go back to high school, women being able to go back to university, women being able to fully go back to work. And again, this is not just about women and girls. When you look at the statistics, they speak for themselves. So when girls are restricted from going to high school, it actually costs globally between $15 to $30 trillion in lost earning potential. When right now in Afghanistan, the restrictions on women being able to work costs the economy up to $1 billion, or 5% of GDP. So this is not just about women and girls, although of course it is, but it's also about Afghanistan and its future.
And do you assure the women here in Afghanistan that they will have the support of the United Nations?
This is one thing that we know, that UN women will continue to do whatever we need to do to be able to have impact in the lives of women and girls. Mm-hmm. Rethink, redesign, whatever we need to do to stay and support women and girls and express our solidarity with them. We're not going anywhere.
Right. Mr. Puzzle, if I ask you a few questions on humanitarian assistance, like how is humanitarian assistance being delivered to Afghanistan following the restrictions? despite the fact that some of the NGOs, as you pointed out already, they have ceased their oppression.
Yeah, that's the problem. Normally also UN organizations implement humanitarian assistance through NGOs, international NGOs, national NGOs. In these NGOs, 30 to 40% of the workforce, of the employees, are female. They are not, they are CEOs of NGOs, they do accountancy, they fill in checks, and they do all sorts of work. And if they can't work anymore, then whole NGOs will be affected, and some had to shut down their activities because they are dependent on women's work, which is quite normal. On the other hand, you know, to reach women in this country, you need women. You know, men cannot reach out to women. So if you want to have to reach out to women who are actually sometimes the only breadwinners in the families, women-run households, you need women to reach out to them. And if that's not the case, I mean, there are some examples, some exceptions, exemptions now in the health sector, in the education sector, but all in all, the work of NGOs has already been negatively affected by the ban on women to work for NGOs.
And my last question to Ms. Alison, what promises do you want to make for the Afghan women on this International Women's Day?
So to Afghan women, I want to say that the struggle for women's rights is a fierce struggle everywhere in the world. But nowhere do more lives depend on it than right now here in Afghanistan. And as UN Women, we will do everything that we need to do, that we can do, to have impact in the lives of Afghan women and girls. That we will continue to stay by Afghan women and girls, and that we're not going anywhere. We will be here with Afghan women and girls, standing beside them.
Ms. Alison Davidian, UN Women Representative in Afghanistan, and Mr. Marcos Putzel, Deputy Special Representative of the United Nations Secretary General. Thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate
Thank you.
Sir, khosh amadin.